Hi, welcome to New Life. Today we're continuing to talk about the parable of the sower. If the word of God does not find place in your heart, it's not going to produce the truth and the values and the character, the peace, the love, the joy, the faith, the wisdom, everything that it brings to you, it's not going to be produced in your life. It doesn't grow in your head, it grows in your heart. God's not responsible to take care of our hearts, we are. He brings the seed. It's our responsibility to prepare the heart. And when we do, inside every seed, there is an incredible harvest. There is an abundance of that will meet the need of whatever's lacking in your life. I believe as you listen to this message, it will bring some truths that will help you get past where maybe you're stuck or frustrated because you're not seeing the things you so desire to see. Enjoy the message. Let's go to Mark chapter 4. We'll just do a quick recap. Jesus, in telling the parable of the sower, he gives them a parable, and he says, a sower went out to sow, and some seed fell by the wayside. And the seed that fell by the wayside, the birds of the air came and ate it up immediately. And of course, when the birds eat the seed, there's no return. There's nothing that grows. And then he said, some seed fell among hard ground or stony ground, and immediately it sprang up. It had no depth of earth, but when the sun was up, it scorched it because it had no root. It withered away. And some seed fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no crop. Well, that's a little frustrating when you're sowing seed and you're getting nothing in return, either the wayside or stony or hard ground, stony ground or thorny ground, and nothing is coming back. He said, but other seed, thank God for other seed. Other seed fell on good ground, and it yielded a crop that sprang up, increased, produced some 30, some 60, and some 100-fold. And then he said to them, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. And when he said that, he says, let them be hearing, let them consider and comprehend. Now, he's not talking about the ears on the side of your head. He's talking about hearing with your heart. And then disciples, when they were together with the Lord, they said, Lord, we don't get it. We don't understand really what you're talking about, seed and birds and stony ground and thorny ground and good ground. And we don't get it. So in verse 13, he says, do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all parables? The parable of the sower is very, very foundational to understanding not only other parables, but getting a return in the benefit of God's word working in your life. So he begins to explain it. And he says, the sower sows the word. The seed is the word. God's word is seed. So if the word is seed, then the ground is the heart. Amen. This is just a recap from last week, just to reconnect from where we were last week. And the sow, the seed that goes on the wayside is where the word is sown, and Satan comes immediately to take away the word. Why? Well, because he knows that contained in that word, the potential that is in God's word has the ability to bring a return and a supply to meet whatever the need is of your life. If you take away the seed, you take away the potential and the power of everything that's in that seed. Think about it. Inside every mango seed is a tree waiting to come forth. That tree is locked in that seed. Now, the thing about seed is it has unlimited potential, because if you take one mango seed, inside that seed is more than one tree. Because once you plant the seed, you get a tree, but then from the tree, you get more fruit. So in that one seed is a tree that has fruit, that has more seeds, that has more trees, that has more trees, that has more fruit, that has more seeds, that has more trees, that has more fruit, that has more seeds, that has more. And it just continues to go on and on. One seed. I don't know if it was this service when you've been preaching a message between last week and this week, 8 different times, you forget what you said where. But you take one mango seed, you plant it, you get one tree. You don't get a mango, you get a tree. And if you get 1,000 mangoes from that tree, inside every mangoes is what? A seed. What's inside the seed? Another tree. So from one seed, you get a tree, and from that tree, just say 1,000 mangoes. You'll get more season by season, but just for the sake of multiplication, we get 1,000 mangoes. We take those 1,000 mangoes, eat the mangoes, keep the seed, plant the seed. Guess what? Now we have 1,000 trees. Just from one generation, we went from 1 to 1,000. Now, if we plant, once those 1,000 trees grow, and we get 1,000 fruit from each tree, 1,000 times 1,000 is 1,000,000. A million. We went from 1 to 1,000 to 1,000,000. We get 1,000,000 trees. Now, if you plant 1,000,000 seeds, how many trees do you get? 1,000,000 trees. But if you get 1,000 mangoes from 1,000,000 trees, do you understand that one seed led to 1,000 trees that led to 1,000,000 trees that led to unlimited? And it all started with one, but only if it got planted. If you don't plant the seed, guess how many trees you get? None. How much many mangoes do you get? None. Because if the seed doesn't make it into the ground, there is no future. There's no future mangoes. But once the seed is gone, the potential of the future is gone. Understand why the devil comes immediately and takes away the seed. Because he knows locked in that seed is unlimited potential that God wants to bring into your life. So when it falls upon a stony ground or hard ground, and that's what we went over last week. And that's pains, frustrations, hurts, unresolved issues of the past. Well-worn pathways. If you have a pathway that you consistently walk over and over and over, that ground gets hard. Nothing grows on it. I was talking with my son Stephen last week, and he says, you know, one thing about the seed won't do what a shovel will do. A seed is designed to go into soil that's prepared. The seed doesn't prepare the soil. A seed will not do what a shovel will do. A seed goes into soil that's prepared. And Proverbs 16:1 says the preparation of the heart belongs to man. Not God, but it belongs to man. And if he'll prepare the heart, how many of you know God supplies the seed? Because in the parable of the sower, one thing is consistent. The seed is always the same. The only thing that changes is the ground. Wayside, hard, or thorny ground. But then, and nothing gets produced. Yet it's the same seed that goes into good ground, brings 30, 60, and 100-fold return. I don't know about you. I would love to get a 30-fold return on an investment. How about a 60-fold return? How about a 100-fold? And what's happening in people's lives is they're receiving and receiving and receiving seed, and yet after a while they're going, you know, I've heard so much, but I'm not seeing the benefit in the fruit. I'm not seeing change. And that's the value of the parable of the sower. When we understand this parable, we know what adjustments we can make so the things that we begin to hear in our life are now going to produce in our life and bring forth an unlimited potential of growth and increase in every area. No longer on the wayside or stony ground, which we prayed about last week, but We'll get into now the thorny ground. These are the ones sown among the thorns. They're the ones who hear the word. And the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desire for other things enters in, chokes the word, and it becomes unfruitful. See, stones are not living. Hard ground is not living. It's something of the past. But weeds and thorns are alive. This is present. And one of the deceptive things about this that we really need to learn, it says the cares of this world, the cares, the concerns, or the anxieties of this world that weigh upon us. And a lot of these things really aren't necessarily sin, because we all have cares and concerns. Amen? And they're very natural. I mean, once you start having children, and you had the desire for these children, and then they don't let you sleep, and then they begin to grow up. And you know, the more you feed them, they keep growing. And the more they grow, the more expensive they get. Oh, I got to get my child educated. And so you begin to look at preschools and daycares. They're expensive. And then you see how much a daycare or preschool or kinder is, or pre-kinder, or pre-pre-kinder, then pre-kinder, then kinder. It's like, ay, nako, amazing. And then you get into elementary school. And then you want to put it, I mean, because as parents, we want to give them the best that we can. And then you begin to check out the different schools, and then you see the price of schools, and it's like, oh my goodness. And then by the time this one gets into elementary school, oh, guess what? You made another one. And now you have another one coming here. And so this one's going into elementary school. And then you're realizing, wow, we spend a lot of money on diapers. And then you've got the milk and the formula. And then if you have the ya-ya, or you're going back and forth. And then, oh, that's right, you've got a car payment. And you're making a car payment. And if you live in a house, you maybe have rent for the house, or you have a mortgage payment on the house. And one thing that's really nice to have in a house is called electricity. And Meralco likes to get paid. And besides your Meralco bill, then if you have a cell phone, and depending how disciplined or undisciplined you are with your cell phone bill, it can be either really high and go crazy, and then you lose a lot of sleep because you're thinking, oh my God, what did I do? I was on the internet too long, played too many games, sent too many texts. So you got your cell phone bill, your Meralco bill, your house bill, your car payments, and then if your car breaks, then you have to fix the car, and then somebody gets sick, and you have to go to the doctor. Oh, that's right, you forgot your house payment or your rent payment. Oh, education. One more thing. Food. Yes, that's right. Food. We do need to eat. And besides that, everybody's growing, and they need clothes because those clothes don't fit anymore, and these clothes are old, and so we like to go shop. And then all of these things, which are natural, normal things, they can become weights. They're responsibilities that we as good parents and loving parents or spouses, we want to provide, but after a while, responsibilities can become weights, and if you're not careful, weights can become cares. Cares can turn into anxieties, which become fears. And now the everyday things of life begin to weigh upon you, and they weigh heavy, and you're worried and fearful. You begin your day, and you're already worried about what you're going to do that day. Instead of grabbing hold of verses that says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth. You see, the cares or the worries or the anxieties of life, present day pressures that we all face, if we don't learn how to cast those cares on the Lord, they become heavy. And we lose our joy. And when we lose our joy, we're easily irritable. And when we're easily irritable, unfortunately, we are irritable and unkind with the people that we're closest to, which are the ones that we love the most. And we're the rudest to the people that we love, because if we were that rude to our friends, they wouldn't be our friends anymore. Is any of this true? Yeah, and what happens is the pressures and the pains or the challenges of everyday life become a care, it becomes a weight, and it gets heavy on us. And these cares, or the cares of this world, or the deceitfulness of riches, thinking that, well, if I get this, it'll make me happy, and if I get this, and so we compromise our convictions or our values or our priorities, thinking that if I get these things and I get this promotion, it'll get me happy. And you go for the riches and you go for the things or you go for the position and you compromise what's really important, like your relationships, your wife, your kids, or going to church. Let me say that again. Or going to church. How many know it's important to forsake not the assembling together of the saints? I've seen some people so down and out. And when they are down and out, they are in church. Worshiping, praying, believing God. Up here after the service, pastor, pray for me. I've got a job interview. Pray for this contract. Pray for this, pray for that. And they come in, they said, I've got a seed I want to sow. I'm trusting God, I'm believing God. And they're in church, they're worshiping, they're hearing the word. They're hungry. The job comes through. The contract gets signed. And God begins to bless and bless and bless. And after a while, you see them once a month because they're out enjoying the blessing. And they forgot the blesser. Until the blessings begin to wane again, and then all of a sudden they need God. the deceitfulness of riches. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. The cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desire for other things. Our life gets so full that these things weigh down and they begin to put pressure upon that word and they actually suffocate it. So you have the pain of the past, the pressure of the present that comes to steal the potential of your future. And this is where Jesus is saying, look, you got to protect the seed. You've got to prepare your heart, because when I bring this seed to your life, inside this seed is everything you're going to need. I'm going to plant it in you, and it's going to grow, and it's going to bring forth a strength, a joy, a peace, a wisdom, a vision for your life, a direction for your life, a confidence in life, an authority over anything that would stand against you, an ability to pray, a rejoicing. It's going to change your heart. Therefore, it's going to change the words of your mouth, but you got to let the seed find its way into the ground if it's going to produce anything in your life. Basically, the parable of the sower is this. If God's word doesn't find place in your heart, it will not produce in your life. So how many of you could say maybe you have a few cares? I think we all do. Let me tell you, building this church and every time we go to do something and every time we step out and when we went to do the generator, anything we do, we make decisions and the board, and we talk, and myself and Pastor Joey and now Jocelyn and Mylene and Rico as he watches over the finances. But one of the things we're careful of is to not make decisions where we get crushed with this weight and this care. And that's why you need to know the will of God. Because when you're walking out the will of God, sometimes things don't look so good. Things are a little challenging. And you have to be able to say, look, this wasn't my idea. I'm really walking in the direction you gave me. And since if you're guiding me here, you need to be providing for me here. See, if it's your idea, it's your responsibility. If it's God's idea, he's always responsible for his direction. And that's why when it's, maybe it's not necessarily ministry direction or building a church or anything. Maybe it's just taking care of your family. And cares are natural. Because we want to be responsible. Moms and dads, we want to be responsible. Husbands and wives, we want to be responsible to our family, responsible at work. 1 Peter 5:7 in the Amplified. Casting the whole of your care, all your anxieties, all your worries, all your concerns, once and for all, on him who cares for you affectionately and cares about you watchfully. The Bible says of Abraham that he was fully persuaded that what God had promised, God would perform. Listen, God makes the promise. It comes to you. What do? You receive it. You believe it. But he made the promise. He has to bring it to pass. The one who makes the promise performs the promise. Amen? So before we go any further, I just want us to pray. Leave that verse up there. Because even as we're sitting here, I know people have cares. I know you have natural responsibilities that weigh on you. And you may not understand where it's going to come from. There are things that are happening in my life, even as we pray for the church, or things I desire for me and Shadi or our kids or whatever, or my grandchildren now. And I just have to take care and anxieties and worries and concern and say, Lord, I can't carry this because I must protect my heart, because the weight of the cares are like weeds. That's why Jesus, in the middle of him raising the dead, healing blind eyes, healing the woman with the issue of blood, the guy that was paralyzed, lowered through the roof, and all these incredible miracles that he does, he takes the time to say, hey, let me give you some good, solid teaching here. That will help everything that I say when it comes to you it will produce in your life. Guard your heart. Protect your heart. So the seed goes into good ground. Because the seed is good, but the ground must be prepared. So anything right now that's a weight, I want you just to think about that and just say, Lord, I don't need to carry this. I can't make it work. I can't bring it to pass. I'm really doing everything that I know to do concerning your word. And so I take all of these cares, these worries, anxieties, and concerns, and I just give them to you. It's not that I will become irresponsible. I will still be responsible, but the weight of it, I'm going to give it to him. I cast it all upon him because he cares for me affectionately and cares about me watchfully. I believe if you understood, this is what Paul says in Ephesians, oh, the height and the depth and the breadth and the width of the love of God that is beyond understanding. If you really knew and understood how loved you were, a beyond religious mindset and teaching and indoctrinations of the past of God being mean or angry or irritated or disappointed, if you understood the depth of the love and the affection that this holy, wonderful God has for you, that he cares about you affectionately and cares about you watchfully, you would take the cares and go, Dad, look, I can't carry this. I don't want to carry this. It's suffocating and squishing the truth of your word that comes into my heart. So I'm going to take all my care. And Jesus goes, I got it. I got it. I got this. I got this. When Shadi was sick, that's something that I consistently told her. I said, I got this. Whatever comes up, honey, I got it. I'll take care of it. Don't worry. I got it. Not me and Jesus, we got it, because there's things I can't do. He can. But I believe the Spirit of God wants to step into your life and some of your greatest pains, your deepest worries and fears, and say, hey, I got this. I got this. Will you release it? No, Lord, I got to carry this. Somebody has to worry about this stuff. No, you don't. You need to release and cast your cares, your worries, your anxieties, and your concerns all on him. Anybody have some? Want to do some casting? Two words that are going to stick today, casting and fling. We'll get to fling later. First, we need to cast. You ready to cast? Anybody have something you need to get rid of? Anybody in the balcony got something you need to get rid of? You guys are closer to heaven, so it'll go faster. Lord Jesus, there are worries and weights and concerns and anxieties that weigh upon us. Some are just natural responsibilities, but they're overwhelming. And we get tired. And not only do we get tired in body, but we get heavy in heart. And it's a weight, and it's not only weighing upon us, but it's suffocating the seed that's coming into our heart. And we need that seed to produce. We need that seed to spring forth and bring in a 30, a 60, or 100-fold return. We don't need seed damaged. We don't need it suffocated. We don't need it stolen. So we take our cares and our worries and our anxieties, and we cast it upon you. Lord, I release right now that weight. I can't carry it, but you can. You watch over me affectionately and carefully. You are concerned about every area of my life. So I refuse to allow that weight, that worry, that fear to steal my joy and rob my peace. So I cast my cares and anxieties on you, and I release it to you in Jesus' name. Let me encourage you, when you get up in the morning, and if you're already worried or concerned about the day, just stop and begin your day. Say, Lord, wait. This is the day you have made. I will rejoice and I will be sad. No, I will be glad in it. So I'm going to take my cares, my anxieties, and they may be legitimate responsibilities that concern you, but you can't bring it to pass. You can pray, and as you pray, you're inviting God into that situation, but let God take care of it. You pray, you cast your care, and say, Lord, I'm just going to trust you. I'm going to commit my way unto you, trust in you. I'm going to let you bring it to pass because I can't do it. And what that does is it lifts that pressure off you, and that weed, you basically take these weeds. It's like going through your garden, plucking up these weeds and say, you know what? You are not going to suffocate what God is growing in this garden. I'm going to have a return. And so you just take those cares and you pluck them up and you throw them away. Amen? When Jesus, after he finished the parable of the sower, again, he said in verse 23, if anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. Then in verse 24, he says, take heed to what you hear, for with the same measure that you use it, it will be measured to you. And to you who hear, more will be given. Basically, he says, the amount of energy and effort and attention that you give to what you hear causes it to be returned back to you. So I want to encourage you, have ears to hear. Listen, receive, consider, understand, and comprehend. Let's go to Isaiah 55, verse 8. It says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. As the rain comes down from heaven and the snow from heaven, and they do not return there, but it waters the earth and make it bring forth and bud. See, the rain, and God says, look, I'll bring forth the rain and the snow, and I will cause the earth to bring forth what's growing. See, what I'm doing today is sowing, but God is the one who gives the increase. Amen? One sows, others water, but God gives the increase. But the responsibility of the heart belongs to us. He says the rain comes down from heaven and the snow does not return. It waters the earth to make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. He said, listen, I'm going to make sure that something grows that will feed you, meet your need, and then also give you something to increase for the future. I'm going to take care of you now, and I'm going to bless your future. How many of you know that's a good deal? See, he gives you bread for the eater. So eat the bread, but sow the seed. Now, some people say, yeah, but I like seeds on my bread. No, no, don't eat your seed. If you eat your seed, you just ate your future. Your future is in the seeds. Amen? So he says he gives seed to the what? Sower. It doesn't say he gives seed to the eater. He gives seeds to the, and if you sow it, will it produce? Seed not sown will never grow. He said, look, I will cause things to grow. I'll give you bread to eat. And I'll give you seed to sow. Do you realize that when God gives you seed to sow, he puts your future prosperity in your hands. He takes it out of his because he's done his part. Listen, God always does his part. He always. See, that's what the grace of God does. It makes everything available. You can't make it available. God makes all things available. The Bible says when we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He gave Jesus to us and loved us before we ever loved him. So he makes everything available and provides, and then it's our responsibility to respond. Amen. He says, I give bread to the eater and seed to the sower. Eat the bread. Say that with me. Say, eat the bread. Sow the seed. Don't sow the bread because bread won't grow. I mean, it might grow mold, but it won't grow a plant. Eat the bread, sow the seed. So I have some people say, well, I don't understand. He's more blessed than I am. That's not fair. Well, he ate the bread, he sowed his seed. You ate your bread, and you ate your seed. You ate your future. Yeah, but I was hungry. Well, you should have thought about tomorrow and the next day and the next day. And then he says, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void. It shall accomplish what I please. It shall prosper in the thing for which I send it. He said, listen, my ways are not your ways and my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are higher. Everybody say higher. How many of you want to live at higher ways? Well, the way you get to higher ways is you have higher thoughts, because low-level thoughts have low-level living. High-level thoughts have high-level living. I'd rather live at a higher level. Amen? And God said, listen, my thoughts are not your thoughts. He didn't say you can't get my thoughts. He just said my thoughts are higher. And because my thoughts are higher, my ways are higher. If you want higher ways, you have to get higher thoughts. Well, get God's thoughts, then you get God's ways. Which means to get God's thoughts, you let go of your thoughts. And when you get God's thoughts, then you get God's ways. He's saying, listen, my thoughts are higher, my ways are higher. And then he begins to talk about how that comes to pass. It's because of his word. Because how do you get God's thoughts? You hear God's word. When you get God's word, you understand God's thoughts. And when you believe in God's word, God's thoughts, then you can begin to walk out God's ways. And when you begin to walk in God's ways, he said, listen, my word is going to provide for you. It's going to feed you, but it's also going to give you something to sow. And the most important thing that gets sown is not an offering that you give out. The most important thing that gets sown is what God is growing in you. See, what he's growing in you is of the greatest value first. Not what he can grow for you, but what he can grow in you, the kind of person that you are becoming. I believe in miracles. Casting out devils, laying hands on the sick, and praying for people, and healings and miracles. I believe in signs and wonders. I believe in that. We pray for people every single service. This morning there was a lady at the end of the service. She was back there on a stretcher, and at the end of the second service, Rico came up and got me, and she's just dealing with kidney failure and problems, but man, she's back there on a stretcher, laid out in church, hearing the word. I went back there, laid hands on her. I believe for a miracle to touch that woman's life. I believe for the power of God to invade her situation. Amen. We believe in the miraculous. But the majority of the things that you will walk in on a daily basis don't come by me laying hands on you and giving you a miracle. The majority of the things that you are going to live in on a daily basis is going to be based on the fruit that's growing out of your inner man. See, the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace and patience and gentleness and kindness and faithfulness and self-control. You know what self-control is? The ability to control yourself. And that's something that comes out of your inner man. It's not the works of the flesh. It's not anger and jealousy and criticisms and judgments. It's not the outer man, but there's something growing on the inside that's manifesting on the outside. And what's growing on the inside is determined by the seeds you let get planted in your heart. And there are some people that are born again. They love God. They're going to heaven, washed by the blood of the Lamb. But years and years later, there's still areas of their life where they haven't really changed that much, because there's still areas where there's a lot of hard ground and thorny ground. And the word that would bring change and begin to develop some areas in their life, every time God sows seed into their heart to fix that barren area, it gets choked. That's why the parable of the sower is so important. Because contained in the seed is the miracle, is the answer for your need. But it's got to get planted. Inside every seed is a tree waiting to come out. Just waiting to just bust out. Just in there going, come on. Somebody plant me. Somebody get me in the right position because I'm in here. And there's so much in here. Just seed, just waiting to just bust out. But it's stuck inside that shell till it gets planted in you. You let that seed get planted in you and it goes down deep and all of a sudden, release, and the roots go down and this tree starts coming out and fruit starts coming out, and all of a sudden you realize, whoa, man, there's some joy I didn't have before. There's some peace I didn't have before. There's some self-esteem and dignity that's been restored into my life. There's a confidence. There's a faith. There's a vision. There's things that are just growing on the inside and just spilling into the outside. In fact, fruit can't be hidden. See, the thing about fruit is it doesn't lie. You could say, that's a mango tree. But if there's bananas, it's a banana tree, right? How many of you know that fruit doesn't have to argue? If you've got mangoes, you don't have to argue. This is who I am. Why? Look at my fruit. See, when you have fruit coming out in your life, you don't have to advertise. Fruit speaks. And that's where you and I will live most of our life. The fruit of the Spirit of love and joy and peace and patience and gentleness and kindness. That's what I want to live on. But you see, what's growing in me is going to come out on the outside. Amen. In James chapter 3, let's go there. It says, if you have, in verse 14, if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but it's earthly, it's sensual. Sensual doesn't necessarily mean sexual, it just means fleshly. It's of the sense realm. Your wisdom and your actions are more from the sense realm. They're not really from the heart, they're from your physical senses. What you can see, hear, taste, touch, smell. What looks good, sounds good, feels good. And if you're making decisions based on just what looks good, sounds good, feels good, that's very limited wisdom. And James is saying this wisdom does not descend from above. It's earthly, it's fleshy, it's sensual, it's carnal, and that opens the door for demonic activity. The devil can't just come to you and jump on. You have to give place. But the more you operate in natural, earthly, sensual, fleshly wisdom, that's not the wisdom that God has for you. Verse 17. Now you notice in verse 15 it says, this wisdom does not descend from above. See, I want God's ways that are higher than my ways, remember? My thoughts are higher than your thoughts. My ways are higher than your ways. Well, that means there's a wisdom in a way that's higher than the earth that comes from above. In verse 17, the wisdom that is from above. How many know above is higher than below? How many know above is higher than the earth? The wisdom that is from above is first pure. It's peaceable. It's gentle. It's willing to yield. It's full of mercy and good fruits. It's without partiality and without hypocrisy. Let's look at James 3:17 in the Amplified. The wisdom from above is first of all pure, undefiled. It's peace-loving. It's courteous. It's considerate. It's gentle. Right there, if you start acting like that, some people are going to go, whoa, what happened to you? Because maybe that's not the normal way you act. Peace-loving, courteous, considerate, and gentle, willing to yield. Oh, no, man, you are so incredibly argumentative. And then all of a sudden, you operate from a wisdom that's from above because you're not self-seeking, you're not self-centered. You want a higher thought, and you want a higher way. So you get a wisdom that's from above, and it's pure, it's undefiled, it's peace-loving. It's not cantankerous, it's not argumentative. It's courteous, it's considerate, it's gentle. It's willing to yield to reason. It's full of compassion and good fruits. It's wholehearted and straightforward. It's impartial and unfeigned, free from doubts, wavering, and insincerity. God, give me that kind of wisdom. Well, it's not normal, it's not natural, it's not earthly. It's from above. It's heavenly. And it'll come in the form of God's word. And you see, when that word gets planted in your heart, this is the kind of wisdom that begins to spring forth from your heart. This is what God is wanting to grow in you. See, that's why in Proverbs it says, with all your getting, and with all your understanding, get wisdom. What would happen if you had a wisdom that was peace-loving and courteous and considerate and gentle, willing to yield to reason? You can listen to others without feeling dominated or fearful or insecure. You're full of compassion and good fruits, wholehearted, straightforward, impartial, free from doubt and wavering and insincerity. How many of you want that kind of wisdom? Well, that kind of wisdom comes from above, and it comes from God's word, and that wisdom is contained in his word that he's constantly wanting to plant in your heart. Galatians chapter 6. Well, no, let's go to 2 Timothy 3:16 first real quick. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine. In other words, what we believe in. The foundation of our doctrine comes from the verses that we hear, the scriptures, solid doctrine, solid scriptures. So it's profitable for doctrine, what we believe, but it's also for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. So it will give you the right thing to believe, but it will also possibly challenge you in an area, and it may reprove, it may correct, but it will instruct you in righteousness. Why? That the man or woman of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Let me have verse 17, 2 Timothy 3:17 in the Amplified. So that the man or woman of God may be complete and proficient, well-fitted, and thoroughly equipped for every good work. In other words, that you will not be lacking in any area of your life. Now, Galatians chapter 6. Verse 7 says, do not be deceived. To be deceived is to believe or perceive something that might be real, but it's really not. It's a deception. You know, in the book of James, it says, do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or changing. In other words, don't allow yourself to believe something that appears to be true, but it's really not. Understand this. Every good and every perfect gift comes from above. That God is good. He's always good. So don't let anybody deceive you telling you he might be bad or he's against you. No, he's not. So when Paul is writing here, he says, don't be deceived. Don't believe something wrongly. God is not mocked. God is not blamed. There will be no fingerprinting or blaming or holding God accountable. Because he says, for whatever a man sows, that shall he also reap. God is saying, look, I'm going to bring bread to you. I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to meet your needs. And I'm going to give you seed to sow. Joshua, now leave that there. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8 says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do. Everybody say to do. That you may observe to do according to all that is written therein, then you will make your way prosperous and you will have good success. Say, no, Pastor, you must have quoted that wrong. No, I didn't. Believe me, I've quoted it 1,000 times. No. I don't make my way prosperous. God does. No, God gives you the potential and puts it in your hand and says, okay, here you go. I'm giving unto you everything you need for life and godliness. I'm going to give you bread to eat, and I'm going to give you seed to sow. And whatever you sow, you will reap. So if you sow and you reap it, wonderful. If you don't sow and you don't reap it, don't blame me. The Bible says God has no respecter of persons. And some people look at others and go, it's not fair. Look at what they have. You know, you don't know the hours that they worked. You don't know the sacrifices. You know the sleepless nights and going to school and traveling on buses or jeepneys or waiting in line for hours or the plane rides that people have done and the missing time with family and the sacrifices. And then you look at the success of their business and you think, well, why are they so blessed? Well, let me say, they sowed faithfulness. They sowed diligence. The Bible says the hand of the diligent will be made blessed. There's a blessing on diligence. Diligence is something that you sow. Faithfulness is something that you sow. Obedience is something that you sow. Willingness is something that you sow. And if you're not diligent, you're not faithful, you're not willing, you're not obedient, but you want the same thing everybody else has. Wait a minute. What you're so... One person was sleeping 4 hours a night, riding jeepneys for 4 hours, going to school, living on Sky Flakes and coffee for a couple years while they went through school. You were going to McDonald's and playing video games all day, and 5 years later, you want the same thing they have. Sorry. They sowed. They sowed diligence. They sowed faithfulness. You sowed leisure. The Bible says the lazy man, Proverbs, the lazy man will not plow because of winter. Therefore, when the harvest comes, he will beg because he has nothing. See, when it's time to plow. Because if you plow, then you'll plant. But if you don't plow, you won't plant. And if you don't plant, you won't harvest. See, God is not mocked. Whatever you sow. And that's why when he comes to your heart with his word, he's saying, listen, I want to grow something that's unlimited in your life. Ooh, if you just knew the power, the vision, the prosperity, the purpose, the potential, the strength, the health, the joy, and everything that was contained in this seed. But I've got to get it in your heart. And if you'll let me sow it, I will cause it to increase. But it must come into a prepared heart. With no heaviness, no sadness, no ground full of rocks. Rocks on the bottom and thorns on top. This seed doesn't have a chance. Even though it's God's word, everything's out to attack it. Because the enemy wants to destroy, because he knows inside that seed is that tree just going, come on. Let me out of here. Every time I preach, it's my prayer to bring buckets of seed. Oh, you, if it wasn't for the fear that I might offend somebody, I was going to bring seed today and just throw it on everybody. But I might offend somebody if I did that. Ut would not like seeds in her hair. But every time I preach, and it's not just because of my words, but his word. God says, my word doesn't return void. I'll feed you now and I'll give you seeds for your future. I'm going to grow things in you for your future. I'm going to grow things for you for your future. I'm going to feed you now, but I'm going to give you the potential for future. So don't blame me. Don't mock me. Don't get angry with me. Because whatever a man sows, he shall reap. He who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will reap everlasting life. Verse 9. Let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season. In due season. Say due season. How many of you are due for a season? In due season, you shall reap if you don't lose heart, if you don't give up, if you don't quit. I mean, think about Psalms 1, blessed is the man who walks in all the counsel and godly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. He will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, whose leaf does not wither, who will bear fruit in due season. And whatever he does will prosper. You see, I want to be that tree. Do you want to be that tree? Matthew chapter 12, we'll finish with this. We began this message with cast. We're going to finish the message with fling. Matthew 12, 33, either make the tree good or its fruit good, or else make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For a tree is known by its fruit. People are known by their fruit. Not the t-shirts you wear, your fruit. If a tree has no fruit, if you don't really know what trees are, the kind of trees, I mean, you know, you could lie to somebody and tell them that a kasha tree was a mango tree. And they wouldn't know. Say, that's a mango tree. Well, no, it's not. It's an acacia tree. You could tell, especially a foreigner, you could look at a kasha tree and tell him it was a banana tree. He wouldn't know. But if it has fruit, fruit speaks. That's what he wants in our life. Fruit that speaks. Our life speaks. Verse 34, brood of vipers, how can you being evil speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things. An evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart brings forth evil things. Now let's go to verse 34 in the Amplified. I mean, this is Jesus talking. I mean, he gets dealing with the religious people. He doesn't play around. You offspring of vipers. I mean, that's basically saying, you son of a snake. I mean, he just lays it out there. This kind, gentle Jesus, he lays it out there. You son of a snake. How can you speak good things when you're evil, wicked? For out of the fullness, the overflow, the superabundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. That's why so many people are struggling. Oh, I've got to control my mouth. I got to stop. You're never going to control the mouth. You want to fix the mouth, change the source. Your mouth is a spout for your heart. And until you change what's in your heart, you're not going to stop what's coming out of your mouth. The good man from his inner good treasure. And the Greek word for treasure means wealth of deposit. What is the wealth of deposit God is putting in you? How many of you like to window shop? Me, I like to go and buy and take home. Now, can you imagine the worst place to window shop is the grocery store? Would you go to the grocery store for 45 minutes and just walk and look at grapes and bananas and apples and sayote and fish and pork and beef and eggs and canned goods and walk up and down the aisles of the store and after 45 minutes leave and you bought nothing? Oh, what a waste of time. And don't come to church and sit here for and then go home and you don't know what truth you took home with you. Don't window shop. Come in with a heart that's open and say, Lord, I have need in my life. I have areas that need to grow and increase. You speak to my pastor. You give my pastor a word that, listen, you put a demand on the Father to put a demand on me. You put a demand on the Father to put a demand on Joselle or Mylene or Joey or anybody that comes up here. When you come into church, you say, Lord, I need a word from heaven. I need things that are going to encourage me. You better bless my pastor. Give my pastor something good because I need help and I need something I can take home today. I'm not here to window shop. I'm not here to waste my time. I need a truth deposited in my heart that's going to grow and bring 30, 60, and 100-fold return. I need a wealth deposit. I need to build my inner good treasure. A good man from his inner good treasure flings forth. Everybody say flings. Flings forth good things. An evil man out of his inner evil storehouse. There's a difference between an inner good treasure and an inner evil storehouse. where you store up past hurts, past offenses, past disappointments, past frustrations, and at any given time, you just fling out your frustrations. You fling out your insecurities and your anger. You fling out your judgment, and you're just constantly flinging, and you're flinging hurts and wounds and makes the people around you sad. Where is it coming from? It's coming because you have a storehouse that you have kept and allowed things to build up. Say, not me. Not after today. Say, that's not. So I don't have an inner evil storehouse. I did. Oh, man, I used to fling. Man, I could fling harshness, judgments, anger, frustrations, harsh tone. That's flinging. How many of you maybe need to deal with some flinging? Negative flinging. Nobody wants to raise their hand. That's okay. The truth will set you free. But a good man, out of his inner good treasure. What's the inner good treasure? That's where the word has fallen upon good ground. And is bringing 30, 60. Let me tell you, when the word is bringing forth 100-fold, let me tell you, there is a treasure that is building and is coming in abundance, and you can just fling out love and joy and peace and patience and the wisdom that comes from above that's pure and peaceable and gentle and open for reason. You can just fling that out. You can fling out compassion. You can fling out generosity, because out of the abundance of your inner good treasure, you can just fling it out, because there's life in here and it's coming out of you. That's better than the inner evil. I don't want evil stored or growing. If I'm going to fling, I want it to come from a good treasure. You see, because you're going to live on the outside according to what's growing on the inside. Amen. That wisdom that comes from above, it's going to touch your heart. And it's going to grow in here. And that's why you want to be good ground. Not stony, not thorny, not wayside, but good ground. I believe you're good ground. Come on, how many of you are good ground? Say, I'm good ground. Say, I'm going to fling from my inner good treasure. This week, some good things are going to get flinged. No more evil. Say, how do you stop evil flinging? You change. You get rid of the storehouse. You empty the storehouse. Burn that baby down. Empty out that storehouse. How do you empty it out? Well, you begin to build the other treasure. And the good treasure, see, good is always greater than evil. The Bible says, be not overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. And a good treasure always overcomes an evil treasure. How does it happen? You just let it grow in your heart. Amen? This parable is so incredibly important, because we realize that every man, every woman, out of the good treasure of their heart, either out of an inner good treasure or an inner evil storehouse. I don't know about you. I want that inner good treasure that causes me to bring forth, to fling forth that which is life-giving, not hurting, not wounding, not painful. But a good man out of the good treasure brings forth. Why is it coming out of your heart? Well, because you've prepared your heart. You let God's word take root there, and it's growing and it's producing and it's bringing everything needed and necessary in your life. I want to encourage you to join us here every week in New Life. Be blessed.